Subdural hematomas. The purpose of this lecture will be to review the basics of subdural hematomas. By the end of this lecture, you should know the basic anatomy relevant to subdural hematomas. You should know the most common causes of subdural hematomas. You should be able to identify what clinical features are concerning for a subdural hematoma. You should know the different imaging techniques to diagnose a subdural hematoma and each of their limitations. You should understand the basic principles in managing patients with subdural hematomas. Finally, you should know what factors are helpful in determining a patient's prognosis regarding subdural hematomas. A subdural hematoma is a bleed occurring between the dura mater and the arachnoid membrane. To the right is a simple diagram reviewing the layers surrounding the brain. From external to internal, there is the skin, followed by the periosteum, and deeper to that is the bone. Below the skull lies the meninges, which consists of the dura mater, arachnoid mater, and pia mater. The dura mater is the outermost layer of the meninges and literally translates to tough mother in Latin. Next is the arachnoid mater, which is a delicate fiber mesh interposed between the dura mater and pia mater. Finally, there is the pia mater, which is firmly adherent to the surface of the brain. The distinction between an acute versus chronic subdural hematoma is somewhat arbitrary, but can be helpful to communicate to other physicians as the management and treatment can vary depending on the age of the bleed. An acute subdural hematoma is defined as occurring within 14 days of traumatic head injury. The most common cause of an acute subdural hematoma is significant head injury, traumatic brain injury. The mechanism of injury is often from a blunt blow to the skull. The most common source of blood is from tearing of bridging veins within the subdural space. Below is an anatomical depiction of the bridging veins and the relationship to the layers of the meninges. Note, there are other causes of subdural hematomas besides traumatic rupture of bridging veins. Spontaneous rupture can occur and accounts for close to half of chronic subdural hematomas. In rare cases, the bleed source can be from an arterial vessel. Non-traumatic etiologies also include coagulopathies, vascular anomalies, hemorrhagic tumors, infections, and iatrogenic causes. Acute subdural hematomas are more common in the young and in men. This is likely a function of young men being risk takers and physically active, putting them at greater risk for traumatic injury. Chronic subdural hematomas, however, are more common in older patients with significant cerebral atrophy, patients with a history of chronic alcohol abuse, and patients with prior head injury. This is likely a function of cerebral atrophy resulting in enlargement of the subdural spaces and the veins traveling through become distended, making them more vulnerable to injury. A subdural hematoma should be suspected in any patient with significant head injury. Patients can present with focal findings, but more often the exam is non-focal and they simply have a decrease in mental status. The classic case is an elderly patient or a patient who has an extensive history of alcohol abuse who sustains blunt head trauma. Symptom onset may be delayed up to days after the head injury, since the bleed is usually a slow flow venous source. Below is a table listing signs and symptoms for a subdural hematoma. Signs and symptoms of increased intracranial pressure are of utmost importance to identify, since ultimately it can lead to a patient's demise. The Monroe-Kelly doctrine describes a simple but important principle. The volume within the cranium is fixed. The fixed volume consists of three parts: blood, spinal fluid, and brain parenchyma. As you can imagine, if one of the volume increases, for example, blood from a bleed, the pressure increases within the closed cranium. As a consequence, patients may present with the classic findings referred to as Cushing's triad, which consists of hypertension, bradycardia, and a slow irregular breathing pattern. This response is thought to be caused by stimulation of mechanically sensitive regions in the paramedian caudal medulla. At this time, it may be worthwhile to review the different types of herniation syndromes before proceeding. Diagnosing a subdural hematoma is relatively straightforward. The challenging part is to remember to consider the diagnosis in patients presenting with signs and symptoms as discussed on the prior slide. A computerized tomography, or CT of the head without contrast, can readily demonstrate the location and extent of the bleed. To the right is the CT of the head without contrast of a patient presenting with a subdural hematoma. Notice the crescentic hypodensities in the bifrontal regions. Subdural hematomas are not confined by dural attachments at the cranial sutures, like an epidural bleed. This anatomical feature is important to remember as it will help to differentiate an epidural hematoma from a subdural hematoma. Notice the dark or hypodense appearance of the lesion. Blood will appear hypodense when chronic and hyperdense when acute. In some cases, associated soft tissue swelling outside of the skull can be a helpful clue when speculating the mechanism of injury. MRI can also be used to diagnose a subdural hematoma. However, the acquisition time is slower, the study costs more, and in some centers, this may not be available. When managing a patient with a subdural hematoma, start with the basics: airway, breathing, and circulation. After the patient has been stabilized, proceed with a workup, including a complete neurologic exam and appropriate imaging. If there are signs of increased intracranial pressure, consider hyperosmolar therapy to temporize the increased pressure. Mannitol is a quick-acting osmotic agent which can decrease the intracranial pressure. Hypertonic saline is also a reasonable option. Keep the patient's head midline and the bed at 30 degrees, as this can have a major impact on intracranial pressures by allowing blood to flow out of the cranium unobstructed. Patients with traumatic brain injury are a particular risk for seizures, and a prophylactic anti-seizure medication should be considered during the early period after head injury. Frequent neurologic exams as well as a repeat imaging is paramount. Ultimately, if a patient continues to deteriorate despite best medical practices, surgery may be warranted. Neurosurgeons play a critical role in the management of patients with subdural hematomas. There are guidelines to help aid in making decisions on if and when to proceed with surgery. If a subdural bleed is greater than 10 millimeters in thickness, or there is more than 5 millimeters midline shift, evacuation should be performed regardless of the patient's examination or glass glaucoma score. Additionally, if a patient presents with a glass glaucoma score of less than 9 and the subdural bleed is less than 10 millimeters thick, and there is less than 5 millimeters midline shift, but there is a decrease in the glass glaucoma score by 2 and or asymmetric pupils, or an ICP greater than 20, then surgical evacuation should be pursued. Ultimately, the decision should be made with a neurosurgeon on whether surgery is the right option for a patient. There are various surgical approaches to managing a subdural hematoma, including craniotomy with evacuation, or tephanation in urgent cases in the field. Surgeons can also aid in managing intracranial pressures by placing invasive intracranial pressure monitoring devices such as a bolt. Any patient with a glass glaucoma score of less than 9 should be considered for intracranial pressure monitoring. Predicting how an individual will do after sustaining a subdural hematoma can be difficult, but there are some factors that have been identified in helping to estimate outcomes: a patient's exam or glass glaucoma score, age, or signs of herniation have been identified as factors useful in assessing a predictive patient's chance for survival. In summary, a subdural hematoma is a bleed occurring between the dura mater and the arachnoid membrane. The most common cause is head trauma resulting in injury to bridging veins. Patients with significant cerebral atrophy, such as the elderly and chronic alcohol users, are at the greatest risk. The clinical presentation can be variable, but a subdural hematoma should always be considered in a patient presenting with significant head trauma. CT is a sensitive and fast way to detect an acute subdural hematoma. Management of intracranial pressure is essential, and ultimately, the patient may require surgery to remove the bleed.